for this course on cornea and associated cataract. And at the outset, I would like to welcome and thank the organizing committee. So, can you start? Fast. So, our first speaker is Dr. Namrata Sharma, and she will be speaking on cataract associated with corneal endothelial dystrophy, Fuchs endothelial dystrophy. And we know that followed by Dr. Suhas, myself, Dr. Ramamurthy, Dr. Rajesh Fogla, Dr. Revati, and Dr. Praveen Dhanpal. So we will stick to our time, and we begin now. May I request Dr. Namrata Sharma to come for her first talk. Dr. Rajesh, can you come to the dais, please? Dr. Revati, please. Revati, please come. Dr. Rajesh, may I request Dr. Rajesh Fogla for his talk on managing a case of cataract post keratoplasty. Actually, this course is designed for various corneal pathologies and associated cataract. What is the best way of managing such situation? And the expert faculty in their respective field have given their valuable time over here, and we know that they are so talented. Dr. Rajesh Fogla is from Hyderabad, and he's a wonderful, prolific corneal surgeon, and he has a lot of publications. Dr. Namrata.
Good morning, everybody. At the outset, I would like to thank Purendra for making me part of his course. The topic of managing cataract post-keratoplasty. The cataract which occurs post-keratoplasty can be a natural progression of the lenticular changes. It can be secondary to intraoperative trauma during penetrating keratoplasty because of manipulation with the instruments. Or post-operatively, it can be either induced secondary to inflammation or with the prolonged use of topical steroids. So what do we look for when we do cataract post-keratoplasty? I think the timing of cataract surgery is guided by the extent of lenticular changes. Obviously, when you do a keratoplasty and if your patient has a cataract, you don't want to immediately go in and do your cataract surgery. You want to wait till the wound healing of the graft is complete. You ideally would want to do all the suture removal and wait for a stable corneal surface. At least topography done 3 months apart should show a stable topography. And if you do have astigmatism, this can be either regular or irregular. This has to be managed prior to managing cataract. You can do astigmatic keratotomy, which can be either manual or femtosecond laser assisted, especially if the astigmatism is pretty large. Or you can resort to doing a topography guided laser treatment to try and make the surface more regular. And with the presence of astigmatism up to for the normal toric lenses up to 4 to 5 diopters, you can use the conventional toric IOLs. Beyond that, you can even customize toric IOLs with regular astigmatism for the cataract surgery. Now, this is a patient where patient had astigmatism almost up to 10 diopters. So we use the femtosecond laser to make paired arcuate incisions just inside the graft-host junction. And you can see that after using the femtosecond laser, the paired cuts, which were for 1 clock hour, we are at 90% depth. We are just using the Sinsky hook to open up the cuts which have been made. And that's the post-op appearance of the patient. And that's the topography. You can see that the astigmatism was pretty large, almost 10 diopters. And after using the femtosecond laser-assisted arcuate keratotomy, we were able to bring it down to something like 6.5 diopters. And after that, the patient successfully underwent a toric IOL. The other thing you can do is, like in this patient, the pre-op cylinder was almost about 7, and the patient had very early cataract, so before going and doing a cataract surgery, we decided to do a topography-guided laser ablation, surface ablation, and you can see that we brought down his astigmatism to about 2.5 diopters. He was very happy, and later on, as the cataract progresses, and if you have to do, we can manage this with a standard toric IOL. When you do surgery, I think you have to understand that post-keratoplasty, the cornea is a neurotrophic cornea because all the corneal nerve endings have been cut at the graft host junction. Visualization is also an issue. You have to see how clear your graft is. You have to protect the epithelium, and you have to minimize the surface toxicity. So avoid using a lot of topical medication because a lot of these anesthetic drops or the topical dilating drops, they all contain benzalkonium chloride, so don't use them very frequently. During surgery, prevent desiccation of the surface and have your nurse keep the surface moist with the balanced salt solution. I usually like to put methyl cellulose on the surface, which keeps my surface moist. Go in for smaller incisions, and if you have astigmatism, sometimes you can combine this with limbal relaxing incision to manage astigmatism up to 1.5 diopters, especially if you're not using a toric IOL. The second thing that you have is endothelial protection. So if you look at, this is typically what your specular will show when you see a patient several years down the lane following a keratoplasty. The cell counts would be in the range of about, you know, somewhere 1,000, 1,200, sometimes even below that. But what is surprising is that despite having a low cell count, if you look at the corneal thickness, if you see in this case, the thickness is about 505 microns. So despite having low cell counts, the corneal thickness is maintained, and that's because these are healthy endothelial cells. These are not like fukes or where the endothelium is abnormal, and as you have a decrease in endothelial cell count, correspondingly your pachymetry also increases. During surgery, use dispersive viscoelastic to protect the endothelium, minimal phaco energy, and maintain a deep anterior chamber. So even if you have to repeatedly inject some viscoelastic to maintain the depth of the chamber, I think it's important that you do that rather than trying to complete the phaco surgery in one go, and you know, because you're working with a compromised cornea here. And avoid waiting for the cataract to become very hard. So a lot of times when we see cataract post-keratoplasty, we advise the patient not to wait too long, because if they wait too long and if you have a very hard cataract, then sometimes doing a phaco in such a situation may be a bit challenging. And for me, if I see patients like that, and if I see that it's a very hard cataract, maybe I'll resort to doing either an extracapsular cataract surgery or an SICS rather than doing a phaco emulsification. Just to show you one of these cases, this is again a post-keratoplasty. The surface is stable, has astigmatism. We are planning on a toric IOL, so we do mark the surface, mark the axis of the toric IOL alignment, and you can see it's mostly a posterior subcapsular cataract arising from possibly the steroid therapy that's been given over time. We put some methyl cellulose on the surface to protect the epithelium. Use viscoelastic, dispersive, and cohesive both we use. You can use either something like viscote and sodium hyaluronate. Doing the capsular excess, if your view is very good, it's fine. If not, I think you can resort to staining the anterior capsule using trypan blue. That can help otherwise, because if the corneal graft epithelium is not very clear, then while doing the capsular excess, you might lose the edge, and that's not something that you that desirable. So in this case, we had a very good red reflex, so we were able to complete our capsular excess. In terms of incision, in this video, in this surgery, I've done a clear corneal incision, but if your graft host junction is, if you're doing a larger graft, I think you should not have your incision cross the graft host junction. So you can resort to making a slightly scleral incision, which is better because you can avoid manipulation at the graft-host junction. In terms of, this is a soft cataract, so we didn't have to use too much of phaco power. We are able to use most of the aspiration to try and aspirate out the cataract, but if you do have a conventional moderate to hard cataract, you do just like what you would do in a patient with compromised endothelium, you will use all the lower parameters in terms of your flow, in terms of your aspiration and the phaco energy, and you would take time to break the cataract into small pieces and then remove it from the eye. And it's important that you suture your wound at the end of surgery because these wounds, because of the kind of nature, you cannot pressurize the eye sometimes, and because of the graft-host junction being very close to your wound, hydration of the wound is also not advisable because you can sometimes end up creating a DM detachment. So I think best is to place sutures and ensure that your wound is watertight. So in this case, we were able to put the lens and the patient had a very good visual outcome. The other thing that you need to worry about is endothelial rejection because it's a surgical trauma that you're creating, and that can sometimes induce inflammation, and your patient whose eye, the graft has been functioning very, very well, can go in for a rejection as well. So some people recommend starting topical steroids prior to surgery. So if you have a patient several years down the lane following keratoplasty and patient is maybe using steroids every alternate day or not even on softer steroids, you can consider starting a conventional full-strength steroids several days or a week prior to the cataract surgery so that and continue it post-operatively for the next few months. The other thing you need to monitor is the intraocular pressure. And for me, in post-keratoplasty eyes, we avoid using topical NSAIDs unless the patient has that specific risk for developing CME, because topical NSAIDs are not very friendly to the epithelium, and you don't want your surface, which is already slightly, neuropathic, you don't want the surface to break down on the patient to develop an epithelial defect. So basically, in conclusion, cataract surgery in post-keratoplasty eyes, it requires some amount of pre-op planning. Stable topography is essential for IOL power calculation, and if the patient has preoperative astigmatism, I think before you embark on a cataract surgery, try and see what options you have to try and manage the astigmatism, especially the irregular astigmatism, make it regular, because in an irregular astigmatism, even if you put a toric IOL, the patient's quality of vision is not going to be very great. Modification surgical steps and perioperative care, both starting pre-op and post-op, can ensure survival of the corneal graft. And always remember that additional procedures may be necessary to refine the refractive outcome. So this needs to be conveyed to the patient. Often we have done surgery and later on we find that there are some residual errors. So you can either look at doing a laser-based procedure on the cornea, or if the cornea does not allow a laser-based procedure, you can think about putting a piggyback IOL. And the one important thing which I have not mentioned here is that when you do a cataract surgery in post-keratoplasty eyes, always discuss the possibility of the graft failing and the patient requiring an endothelial keratoplasty later on, because this is something you cannot predict, because a lot of these low cell counts, despite the best of your effort, it's possible that after the cataract surgery, the graft may, you know, it may not happen immediately after surgery, but gradually down the lane, the graft may fail because the cell counts have further decreased. So this is something that if you discuss with the patient preoperatively, the patient will be more amenable later on for a second procedure. Otherwise, if you have not discussed this, you'll always find fault that when you've done the cataract surgery, you've damaged the graft, which was functioning very fine for a long time. Thank you. Thank you for a patient hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Rajesh. Any questions? You may have the lights, please.
If I have two topographies 3 months apart which are stable, I think that's sufficient. Unless the patient has a total cataract intumescent or something which requires immediate, then sometimes we go ahead and we don't wait for such long. But otherwise, at least you do a suture removal, post-suture removal, do a topography, call him back 2 to 3 months topography, and you find the topography is not changed, safe that, you know, this is unlikely to change anymore.
So you said, discussed one case of astigmatic
yes.
keratectomy, and what will you prefer, astigmatic keratectomy or the laser correction?
The laser correction for 10-11 diopters is not something advisable, and I think the laser correction is guided by the amount of corneal tissue that you have. If my patient's corneal thickness is already in the range of 490-500, and then remove you know, creating haze in the cornea. So I always look at the astigmatic keratotomy does work, and it can reduce the magnitude of astigmatism, bring it down to a level where I can manage with a toric IOL. So, you know, so always you have to choose judiciously between the procedures that you have. I know people may say that we can do laser and remove 8 diopters of astigmatism, but at the same time, you'll have to use a lot of steroids, think about haze, and all this, you're flattening the cornea as well. So, and post-keratoplasty, sometimes the grafts, the corneas are already a little flat. So if you make the cornea very flat, the patient's quality of vision may suffer. So I think in that procedure, doing an astigmatic keratotomy is something which is better.
Especially with the femto.
Femto has made it very, very, very nice, and you can actually choose an optical zone size. So for me, I think if I use a 7 millimeter, I get a pretty, you know, the smaller the zone you choose, the larger the amount of correction you have. So I think I'm very comfortable using a 7 millimeter optical zone and achieve a reasonably. And also, if your topography is asymmetric astigmatism, like the Zima that we use, allows me to do a different cut on either side, so I can choose to do a 30 degrees on one side and a 60 degrees cut on the other side. So thereby, depending on the topography, I can customize my astigmatic cuts to make the cornea more regular.
Also in these cases, if you want to do a LASIK, the thing is that you have to do a sequential procedure. So first you just have to do a just the microkeratome cut or the femtolasic cut, wait for about 4 to 6 weeks, and then lift up the flap, and then do the laser at all for the refractive correction. And that is because the initial cut itself acts like a relaxing keratotomy, or like a astigmatic keratotomy, which is, you know, that large. So that itself will allow about a couple of diameter, that will take care of 1 to 2 diopters of astigmatism.
What thickness flap, Namrata?
Sorry?
What thickness flap are we talking about?
No, what thickness flap? You can, this is more so if you take, say, about a 180 flap.
Yeah. So not, because nowadays, most of the flaps we do with a 90 or 100. So if we do that with a femto, we don't see too much of a change. Yeah, but yes, with, if you have a 180 micron flap,
if you have a 180
definitely you will see, you'll see some
so
amount of change.
And then after 4 to 6 weeks, you just lift up that flap that you had created, and then do the laser for the residual correction.
That's very interesting, Namda. I've never heard of this. I mean,
this is published. This is published.
I just want to understand. I mean, what I'm saying is, I'm not a cornea surgeon, more a refractive surgeon, because my understanding is this: you create a flap of almost 330 degrees or 300 degrees.
Yeah, that
astigmatic keratotomy essentially work by positioning you this thing at a certain axis.
No.
The depth also is quite.
The idea is not that, I'm not saying that it will work as well as astigmatic keratotomy, or it will be as predictable. The only thing is, what it allows you to do is, it just relaxes your the tension that is present at the graft host junction. And then it allows you to do, and in these cases, we published two of our, one was published in American Journal of Ophthalmology, and the other in Journal of Cataract and Refractive Surgery. And again, I'm sure Fogla will also agree with me, the moment you do that flap, then it you know, decreases those tension lines, and it decreases your astigmatisms. It won't decrease every time by 2 diopters, but up to 2 diopters. That is the amount of correction that we've got with it. And then whatever is left behind, then later on, then you can address the residual refractive error. So it does relax, and a cylinder goes away by, you know, 1.5 to 2 diopters.
I think generally it reduces the irregularity, because the graft host junction will act like a second limbus, where all this tension and irregularity. So you make a cut larger than the graft host junction.
Yes.
That reduces the.
And it has to be sufficiently thick. If you have a very thin one, it doesn't. If you're sufficiently thick, it basically breaks the graft host junction. So whatever tensions are at the graft host junction, it relaxes. So then the surface has a chance of.
Have you ever seen the graft host junction giving when you make this cut? How much time do you last after suture removal before you make this cut?
Sorry?
After suture removal.
No. For this, all the sutures should be out.
Yeah.
So no, that so means it is after almost 1 year, more than 1 year. Sutures have to be out for this.
We'll take 2 questions after the talk, after each talk. Thank you, Dr. Rajesh Fogla, for this interesting talk. next order is after Namrata, there was Suhas. As Namrata was not ready, so we asked Dr. Rajesh. So let's next please.
So thank you, Parendra, for making me a part of this course, and I'll be talking to you about phacoemulsification in cataract with endothelial disease. Sorry. Here also it is not moving. Okay. It's not moving. Okay. No, there is some problem. It's not moving. So meanwhile, you can take a couple of questions if there are, because this doesn't seem to move.
Dr. Fogla, if there is a mature cataract before the time, before the suture removal or something, would you like to do it as a two-stage procedure, remove the cataract alone and then later a secondary IOL? Because if it is mature or like, no, we don't.
This is a problem. Audiovisual is a huge problem.
Yeah.
We remove the cataract because the cataract is something that has to be managed. We can put in a standard IOL. And the astigmatism part, depending on once the suture removal is done, we can then manage it depending on the magnitude and whatever options we have.
Any special tips for post-disec?
Nothing. Post-disec or DMEC, it doesn't bring the graft out or anything. It's quite well adherent. Just that you have to take precautions as just you would do with any compromised endothelium. I think what we advise sometimes patients for surgeons doing surgery in post-keratoplasty eyes, you can actually connect an AC maintainer and let it run on. So what happens is when you do surgery, you come out with your instrument, your chamber never collapses, it always remains firm.
Thank you.
Routinely also, do you think that we can, this is just a presumption I'm just asking you, that like in a routine case, you just do this.
Maybe we can just discuss it out what to do.
It's not working.
So, as a routine, you know, like if we manage, like even if there is a 10 diopters of astigmatism or maybe 8 diopters of astigmatism, and then we do a cataract surgery, I will everything, and then later on we manage astigmatism, because we may not be very sure of what kind of an astigmatism may be there after, say, about a few years after cataract surgery. So maybe we wait for some time, let the eye stabilize, let the sutures be more strong, and then handle the astigmatism part of it. Just bear with this astigmatism for some time. Maybe you can use a contact lens or something, and then after some time we can take care of astigmatism, because just risking that kind of a situation after keratoplasty may be a little more tough. Not for you, maybe for other people.
No, that's what I mentioned, that the timing of cataract surgery is dependent on the extent of cataract and how much of visual compromise. So it's not like when you see post-keratoplasty a cataract, you immediately want to jump in and do a cataract surgery. The longer duration you give, the better healing of the graft-host junction. And if you already have removed all the sutures and you have a stable topography, then I think you can go ahead and choose one of the best options that you have.
Yes, I think that's correct.
Okay, so I'll speak from here only because it doesn't seem to function from there. So I'll be talking to about phacoemulsification in cataract with endothelial disease, and there are no financial and 17%. And when you have an endothelial dysfunction, then this may get exaggerated and may lead to corneal decompensation. And these are the situations in which the endothelium is diseased, such as your Fuchs dystrophy, your posterior polymorphous corneal dystrophy, the chronic angle closure glaucoma cases, there's endothelial cell loss. Even in cases of recurrent uveitis, you may have a picture like this with cataract. And in cases of eye syndromes, where you would have to address both the cataract and the diseased endothelium. Then even in cases of recurrent herpetic endothelitis, this may occur. And we need to do investigations which include specular microscopy, corneal pachymetry, and corneal confocal microscopy. And on the specular, you may see pictures such as this. Fuchs dystrophy with the guttata present and PPMD where there's epithelialization of the endothelial cells along with the eye syndrome that you see in the center. Now, it is important to do confocal microscopy and look at what is called as the corneal backscatter. And because if the corneal backscatter values are more than 1350, then it goes more in favor of a simultaneous surgery than a sequential surgery. So when you have a suboptimal endothelium with cataract, you can do a phacoemulsification with intraocular lens implantation, see how it goes and then do a second stage endothelial keratoplasty. Or you may plan a triple procedure depending upon if only the endothelium alone is involved, then you can do an endothelial keratoplasty along with phaco. Or if all the layers are involved, then you have to do a full thickness penetrating keratoplasty with ECC and IOL. So the bigger question is whether we should do the phaco alone or phaco emulsification with endothelial keratoplasty. And the fact whether you will do a single stage or combined procedure, like I said, will depend also on the availability of the donor corneas and the visual requirement in terms of risk-benefit analysis. Now, for the central layers which are involved and for a cataract which is present, you would do a combined procedure. Now, generally, we would like to put a monofocal intraocular lens in these cases. Keratometry may or may not be possible. And again, IOL master may or may not be possible depending upon the haze that is present. So you may have to do biometry. This is what I was talking about, that if you have to see the optimal cutoff points for confocal microscopy, 1894 scatter units. And for corneal thickness, it is 630 microns or 650 microns according to some people. Then for IOL power calculation, you have to again do it similarly because DSEC will give you a hyperopic shift. Whereas a DMEC will give you a shift, which is a hyperopic shift, which is not that much. So generally, standard monofocal aspheric IOLs are preferred. And if the CCT is less than 650 microns with no epithelial changes, cells which are more than 1,000 cells, phaco alone can be done. But if the CCT is less than 650 microns with no epithelial cells, no epithelial changes, cells less than 800 microns, then patient has to be counseled and you can do a sequential phaco plus minus endothelial keratoplasty. However, if the corneal thickness is increased, there's poor view of for phaco emulsification and cells are also decreased, then you have to do a triple procedure. Now this I would be talking to you as I show you the videos, and in this case, this is a case of Fuchs dystrophy, and you can even see on the intraoperative OCT microscope the presence of guttata, and this patient actually didn't want a keratoplasty, so we did a phaco emulsification in this first to see how it goes, and fortunately she didn't require a corneal transplant because visual acuity post-operatively was 6/12. Now in all these cases it is important that you have a good irrigating solution such as BSS plus and you use a viscoelastic agent such as a viscote to do the surgery. Now this is just to show the DSEC triple procedure. Now again in this case the capsulorhexis is done followed by the phaco emulsification, foldable intraocular lens implantation. And this is followed by, this is an older video. If I were to do endothelial keratoplasty in these cases, I would go for a DMEC rather than a DSEC. But you can do, if you're not well versed with a DMEC surgery, you can do DSEC in such cases with the help of the Bucin's glide, the graft is loaded. and with the help of ILM peeling forceps, it is intracamerally injected, followed by the centering of the graft. Now, this is again a case in which we actually didn't think that we would be able to do a corneal transplantation procedure, but this is a case of advanced Fuchs dystrophy, and advanced cases do have hypertrophic epithelium, which has to be removed by doing epithelioresis, followed by the Desmet's membrane, which is quite fibrosed again. And this is stained with a trypan blue dye and is removed from the site. It comes out quite easily, so you do a desmetorexis, and finally you do an anterior capsulorexis because you have to do a phacoemulsification in this case. So after staining it with a trypan blue dye, this is removed, and then you do phacoemulsification. In this you can be, you should be more anterior rather than posterior, because you should not do a posterior capsular tear in these cases, because then it's going to be a disaster because you can't see. So you can afford to be anterior because you anyway have to replace the diseased endothelium. This is followed by foldable intraocular lens implantation. And then on a Bucin's glide, this is the newer version of the Bucin's glide with the plate. The desec lenticule is taken and it is intracamerally injected, followed by the air bubble that is put in and the graft that is centered. So following a desec, it does take time to clear up. If after PK, it takes for visual rehabilitation 1 year. After desec, it takes about three months. And this is after follow-up of 2 years with a good visual acuity and without having to actually put sutures for the graft or do a graft. Just by sticking the graft, this does the magic. Now, the last thing is the DMEC triple. Again, with the help of the Desmet's membrane is scored on all sides, and it is stained with a trypan blue dye, and the Desmet's membrane role is then being, the Desmet's membrane role is now being fashioned. So you just lay it back there, and after you've made a Desmet's membrane role, and then this is the cataract surgery which is being performed, just as you would do routinely. Followed by the viscoelastic injection and the foldable intraocular lens implantation. Important thing is that immediately after you do phacoemulsification, you have to, viscoelastic has to be completely aspirated out, because otherwise it will be there between the graft and the overlying cornea, and it will prevent you to prevent the sticking of the graft. Now this is the diseased Desmet's membrane which is being removed, and after removing this, the Desmet's membrane role, which had previously been prepared, is taken into an injector, and this is then intracamerally injected. It is centered in the center of the cornea, and unlike a desec graft, you cannot move it after you put the air bubble, so you have to center it first and then put the air bubble. So it is not attached right now, and you have to get it into the right configuration, which the intraoperative OCT allows you to see, and once you have the right configuration with the endothelial side down, you inject the air bubble and the graft gets pretty attached to the back of the cornea. And this is the picture on post-op day one, where it has cleared up considerably, and this is the picture on post-op day 10, where you can't even make out that the graft was ever present. And even if you do a cursory slit lamp examination, you cannot make out, you know, that a corneal transplant has been done for this procedure. So thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, Dr. Amrita, for this nice presentation. You said several factors. I mean, is there, was the endothelial cell count beyond which you decide to go ahead and do a combined procedure, or is the morphology also there's equally important?
There is no clear cut because even at 500 cells, sometimes hazy corneas. So basically, you have to go by both the slit endothelium as well as the endothelial cell count. And if you're in doubt at any point in time, it is best first to do a phacoemulsification. See how it goes, and you can always do a graft later on if it is required. Sometimes the patients are just happy with 618, 612, so it's okay. You can leave them at that. and sometimes they are not, then you may have to do, you may have to replace the endothelium.
I think that's an important point I wanted to bring about, because some of the American surgeons seem to be quite aggressive, even in the presence of Fuchs endothelial dystrophy, even if the cornea is clear, based just on the corneal thickness and the endothelial cell count, they recommend a triple procedure.
Yeah.
But I think you can always give the natural cornea to function and then only when it becomes necessary.
Yeah. So that's because they have excess of corneal tissues, and corneal tissues is not a problem.
Rendra was seen to speak on phaco and cataract and corneal opacity.
You have to do or you have to do a combined procedure. Now that slide basically showed that you can get away with a phacoemulsification alone, and in those cases all that you require is that one half of the cornea should be clear so that you can, you know, see. But if it is right in the central bang on, then in that case you have to do a combined procedure, combine it with a corneal transplant.
I think for audiovisual reasons, I am to make my presentation now. The topic Purinder Basin has given to me is cataract with keratoconus post CXL naturally stable. So I must right at the outset confess that I'm essentially a cataract and refractive surgeon. I don't do much cornea work, but have a deep interest in keratoconus, and now I think we are able to deal with many cases of keratoconus without resorting to corneal transplantation. So what are the challenges when cataract coexists with the stable keratoconus? So we assume that either because of the aging of the patient, that is they're beyond 35, 40, or because the cross-linking has been done and both the topography and the refractive status is quite stable, those are the cases which are presenting to us with cataract. Obviously, it's a 25-year-old, it's unlikely comes with a cataract and a keratoconus. You first stabilize the keratoconus and then go ahead and deal with the cataract. So the challenges when these two conditions coexist is that it's been well proven that there's an earlier onset of cataract in keratoconus patients for reasons unknown, whether there's a genetic linkage is something that's being explored. They are more sensitive to lenticular changes. Obviously, the cornea itself is abnormal, and if the lens also becomes abnormal, then both these have additive factors and there's a significant deterioration in the quality of vision. Axial length measurements become somewhat inaccurate because of the protrusion of the cornea, and even more so the K readings are quite unreliable, and there's no dedicated formula that's available to us for calculation of the intraocular lens power in these conditions. And the implantation of toric intraocular lens, we'll discuss it a little later, is somewhat controversial, though it does debulk the amount of astigmatism that these patients have. And the surgery itself becomes more demanding because of the corneal thinning and scarring, and visualization itself might be a little bit of a problem. And there are a few basic precautions that you need to take in these cases. What about if it's an early case of keratoconus, then maybe you can just perform biometry as usual. And then if it's a well-centered cone, then you can implant a toric intraocular lens and a spherical intraocular lens. Most often if these, you know, the semi-soft or the hard contact lens or the row-scale lenses are some of the best ways of rehabilitation, visual rehabilitation of these keratoconus cases. And if the patient has been using it before the surgery, quite often they might have to continue with that for the good quality vision. This is something that you need to forewarn your patients before taking them up for surgery. And in case it's a case of advanced keratoconus, it's a good idea, especially if the cornea is reasonably clear,
and the dismissed endothelium is not involved, you can go, that is, there's been no corneal edema which has come about earlier, you can perform a DALC, wait for stabilization, do a suture removal, wait for about 6 months and then proceed with cataract surgery, doing a calculation like in your usual case. I think that was dealt with by the earlier speakers also. But in case you have an advanced keratoconus and a significant corneal opacity, if there's been a repeated attacks of eye drops, and then you might have to do a PK with cataract surgery. In these cases, you would remove the cataract as a whole and do a combined surgery. And it's a good idea to assume an average K of 43 or 44 diopter. You can go with the holiday K EKR report, but then the final curvature of the cornea may not have any relationship to the pre-existent curvature of the cornea before the transplantation is done. As far as the Yale measurement itself is done, if it's possible, you can do it in the eye getting operated, or sometimes it has to be done on the fellow eye. And if there's no history of anisometropia, then you can use that as a guide for your calculation of the intraocular lens power. K readings is a big challenge because there's very poor repeatability and accuracy. Very often different keratometers give you different readings. And there is a difference between the corneal vertex, that is where the visual axis cuts across the cornea, and the steepest point of the cornea. Assumption that the posterior, just like in post-LASIK cases, we often assume that there's a relationship between the anterior corneal and the posterior corneal curvature. And anterior cornea is just 82% as curved as the posterior cornea. This relationship is quite disturbed in these malfunctioning cornea, and this has to be taken into consideration. So as already mentioned, in severe keratoconus cases, you could use a standard K value of 43 to 44, though that could lead on to some errors in the intraocular lens power calculation. I think our approach to keratoconus and our approach to dealing with the disease itself has undergone a sea change in the last 3 to 4 years. I'm sure the cornea surgeons here will agree with me when I say that the incidence of keratoconus patients requiring a corneal transplantation has significantly come down. Similarly, nowadays we are able to pre-treat and regularize the cornea before taking up the patient for cataract surgery, and I would like to emphasize that at this point with taking a few examples. As far as the centration of the cone is most important, whether you're using a toric ICL or a toric IOL, in case it's a decentered cone and you go ahead and implant a toric lens, or even with a spherical lens, the results are suboptimal because the center of the cornea and the center of the optics of the lens do not coincide, and that leads to a fairly unhappy patient. So how do you judge decentration? Though you could look at the curvature maps, the anterior float maps, essentially the posterior float map that you concentrate on. If the more than 50% of the cone is outside, this is the posterior float map, is outside the central 3 millimeters, that's a decentered cone. Or if the nipple of the cone is outside the central 3 millimeters, that's a decentered cone. This is a decentered cone. On the other hand, this is a reasonably centered cone because you find that most of the coning is inside the central 3 millimeters. And essentially what you try to do is to center these cones before taking up these patients for a treatment. So because I don't have a large series of patients undergoing cataract surgery post with keratoconus, I'm essentially going to deal with some cases of keratoconus, but this will be the principles that will be followed. As you can see over here, this is a fairly decentered cone that we have here. This is essentially a curvature map, and you can see over here also, and you can see the refractive error is there's a significant amount of cylinder, and the best corrected visual acuity is only 6/12. In these cases, we do a topo-guided PRK, and this is what we get. You can see there is still a residual error that's left over, but what you have is a regular bow tie, a fairly centered cone over here. And now, supposing this patient had a significant amount of cataract, this could be dealt with even with the implantation of a toric intraocular lens. So the pre-treatment of the cornea is essentially what is important. So what exactly we have done, this was a preoperative picture. This is the ablation profile, where we apply laser burns in the area of steepening and apply laser burns peripheral to the area of flattening to steepen this area. So essentially, it's a bimodal treatment. with a minimal tissue consumption, so that you regularize the cornea and center the cone, and subsequently go ahead and treat the with the intraocular lens. Looking at another example, you can see this preoperative picture, where it's a decentered cone. Subsequent to the topo-guided PRK, we usually don't remove more than 50 microns of tissue in these situations. What you can see is a very well-centered bow tie, and obviously this can be dealt with the toric intraocular lens. If I were to place a toric intraocular lens in a situation like this, it would lead on to quite an unhappy patient, because the optics of the lens and the optics of the cornea would not coincide. Even though sometimes the cone is reasonably centered, in a situation like this where it's an extremely steep cornea, then it's a good idea to go ahead and do a topo-guided PRK. You can see just with a simple treatment, almost the cornea is completely flattened, and you are able to treat this, and you have an uncorrected visual acuity of 6x6. Obviously, if this patient had a significant amount of cataract, just a spherical lens might be enough to get a reasonably good visual outcome in this particular patient. Then again, we also combine Intax with CXL. Now, whenever it's needed, we combine the two modalities of treatment. You see quite a high refractive error in this patient, the best corrected visual acuity being this. And this is basically, I'm not going into the details of Intax placement, but essentially we combine the two modalities now. And you can see once we have done that, it's a fairly centered cone that we have over here. And there have been more cases of toric ICLs being implanted in our center after this kind of treatment, but there have been a couple of cases where toric intraocular lenses have also been implanted. So this is what is Intax in C2, this would, after the surgery. And this is a cataract surgery per se being done. This patient actually chose to undergo a femtosecond laser. Essentially, you can see the Intax rings that's there with collagen cross-linkage that has been done. Because the size of the capsular excess that you get is limited by the arc length at which the diameter at which these segments are placed. But usually it's you have about within 6 millimeters you can do this. So it's usually a 5.5 millimeter excess that I aim at. And subsequently I'm doing the cataract surgery as usual. Having it pre-treated with the laser is a help, but you can't expect a free-floating capsule in these cases. And because it was extreme high myopia, what you see is a three-piece intraocular lens that's going in, and that's the end of surgery. Toric intraocular lenses, as I said, can be considered when it's a centered cone with a good best corrected visual acuity, and if repeatable topographic and K measurements has to be quite normal. And what are the intraoperative consideration? I think it's one of my last slides. Incision has to be away from the area of thinning and maximal coning. If coning is in the inferior temporal quadrant, you would not stick to your usual temporal incision, but make the incision superiorly. And you have to remember that the corneas are weaker and floppier, and especially if it's extreme case of keratoconus, making sclerocorneal incisions might be a better idea. You also have to realize that the view that you get under the microscope might be quite much more compromised than what you see with your slit lamp, because in the slit lamp it's more oblique illumination, and under the microscope it's a diffuse direct illumination, so that might make surgery a little difficult. So I think the post-operative care, as I already mentioned, you have to tell the patient that contact lenses may have to be continued post-operatively for appropriate visual rehabilitation. Aim for a slightly myopic outcome. Just in case you have a refractive surprise, obviously in these cases it's possible, the patient has to be primed for IOL exchange and a piggyback intraocular lens. Obviously, this patient has lived with a compromised vision right through his or her life, but still it's important that adequate counseling is done before taking up these patients for a cataract surgery. Thank you so much.
Do we have any questions? Sir, as you rightly pointed out, with increasing C3R and stabilizing the keratoconus without going for keratoplasty, I think in future we may come across these kind of patients. These youngsters in the later after a decade, we'll be facing many of these patients for intraocular lens implantation. And then I think by that time, it's better to find out a way, like in post-refractive surgery, to manage these patients, to calculate the proper IOL.
I think right now we're doing quite because they are all, as I said, they are just about three cases of cataracts that we have done in stable keratoconus. But I think it's doable. The most important thing is you have to make sure that the cone is centered, whether already or and then go ahead and do the treatment. Once you optimize the cornea, the results are good.
So is there any differences which you find in the anterior ratio?
Giving these patients, promising these patients refractive accuracy. Sometimes I even wondered whether we should be using the formula that we use for post-refractive surgery patients. But then there it's a fairly regular anterior surface. It's only the change in the difference in the ratio between the anterior and the posterior surface. Here you are essentially dealing with an irregular cornea. So at least for the few cases that we have done, we have just gone ahead and done the usual biometry and gone ahead and implanted the lens. No, but it's always worrying ratio.
So do you have any experience in a patient who has undergone CXL and developed cataract? And
I saw undergone CXL with the intacts and then subsequently underwent a cataract surgery. We have done so far 3 cases. This was one with intacts also. The other cases were just CXL and topo-guided laser done for regularization of the cornea. And once it's a centered cone, then go ahead and in 2 of these cases, we use toric intraocular lenses, and in one case, we use a spherical intraocular lens.
Fine. Thank you. For elaborating us on this difficult topic. Phaco in cataract and corneal opacity, and this is a commonly seen problem which we come across in our day-to-day practice. Various surgical options are that we can go for keratoplasty, whether DALC or PKP, and then we, on a second stage, we do the cataract surgery. This is the ideal and best way, but because of the scarcity of corneas and risk of graft failure, graft infection, secondary glaucoma, and suture-related problems, if the cornea is not much compromised, we can do a conventional phacoemulsification or extracapsular cataract extraction. And the good thing is that in sizable population, there is some amount of clear cornea which is present, and through that we can do the cataract surgery. So various things which has to be taken care of before taking the case for the cataract, that our illumination setting should be appropriate. We can try the position the patient and decrease or increase the light intensity, retroillumination, direction of the light, and using a supplement in illumination by the assistant, a fiber optic light source which is available with the retina person, or maybe transconjunctival chandelier illumination, and retro in the vitreous cavity, if we use a chandelier illumination, that is a new way which I will be showing the video also. And one should use a dispersive viscoelastic, and a soft shell technique is very useful in such cases. Perform sinuculysis, iris sphincterotomy, or iridectomy to increase the area of visualization. And capsular axis should be, all the capsules should be stained with trypan blue. That improves our visualization. And we should do it under high magnification and start and end at the visible area of the cornea. This is very important, and it should be of adequate size. And nucleus emulsification we should be very careful and do a slow motion phaco, and we should be ready to convert to ECC or SICS. So this is a case of adherent leucoma. Almost half of the cornea is involved in this, and the superior half is the area from where the patient, we will be doing the cataract surgery. So as I said, that our capsular access should be in one go, which should pass through the area of the corneal opacification, and we should complete it in one go after staining the capsule with trypan blue. And slow motion phaco chop is the ideal way, maybe crater chop or stop and chop, depending on the type of nucleus, and make small pieces, as small as you can, because the area or the endothelial cell which are available to us are less in number, and the cornea is compromised, and bring them towards the area of where we can visualize them, and try to avoid any
damaged or the pull of the iris towards the phaco tip, and we should work right in the middle, in the center. Our working zone is almost 3 to 5 millimeter only, less than almost 3 millimeter zone. We should do the phaco emulsification, and the cataract surgery and IOL implantation is done in a normal way. So this is how, and we have not touched the area of the corneal opacity in any case. This is a periodic case wherein there is a scarred cornea, self-sealed corneal wound. And there is a adhesion between the cornea, iris, and the anterior lens capsule. So with the micro scissor, we cut this, release it, and by sweeping the iris repositor, we can release all the adhesions, because this eye, if it is left like this, and this can create a uveitis in the post-operative period, and enlarge the pupil by the cutting the iris, and this can be, we can use the vitrector, and because the patient was 5 years old, so we are doing a posterior capsular axis, and as I said, for the capsular axis, maybe anterior posterior, we should not leave it in between in the area of opacity, because then it is very difficult to retrieve it and complete the posterior capsular axis and put the lens in the sulcus, and this way we have rehabilitated him. The patient otherwise, and all these young patients, there is high chance of, we are doing peripheral iodotomy with vitrector, and there is a high chance of PCO in such cases. So posterior capsular axis is of very help in this case. Adherent leucoma, release the adhesions of the iris, posterior synechias are released, they become in traumatic cases, it becomes very difficult to release, and cut the edges of the fibrous anterior capsule with the scissor, and otherwise it becomes very difficult, like as I am seeing, and then you enlarge the anterior opening anterior capsule in a circular fashion, as you can see that I am cutting it with the venous scissor, and then phaco emulsification aspiration is done. Young patients and posterior capsular axis, anterior vitrectomy, and the lens implantation. This is interesting case wherein there is a corneal opacity and fibrosed anterior capsule, post-traumatic, and there is a hypermature cataract. Stain the capsule. You can see that there is an irregular staining of the anterior capsule because of the presence of fibrosis in the anterior capsule. And there is a hazy view because of the presence of corneal opacity. We are not able to see it clearly because there is a hypermature white cataract. But now you can realize that there is a corneal opacity also present here. So we have not completed the anterior capsular axis here because of the leak of the fluid, white milky fluid. And then we complete the axis, and a single piece lens is placed inside the bag. This is the patient with the diffused corneal opacity all over the cornea, and here staining the capsule. What happens is, to begin with, sometimes you see the good retroillumination, under retroillumination you get a good red reflex. But the moment you start doing phaco emulsification, it becomes very difficult and challenging, even in a slighted central corneal opacity. And the anterior capsular axis is done. The moment the nucleus pieces or the lens matter gets hydrated, the visualization becomes very, very challenging in the presence of central corneal opacity. I'm doing a slow motion phaco, and small pieces are At times you feel that you, why have you taken this case for the surgery, but with the newer applications, we can do away in such cases like use of fiber optic light. And this is very, very helpful, which I have found it in the recent times for last, 3 years I am using such technique. And one can use it at the limbus, which I am going to demonstrate here. This is the diffuse central corneal opacity. And ensure hydrodissection. Phaco, here the hold of the phaco is very, very challenging because at, and the nucleus is also not very hard. And here, this fiber optic light, if it is placed at the limbus, you can see the nucleus pieces better. And there is a better visualization. Otherwise, it's very, very challenging. Now you see that the piece has come to the tip, and you can perform it in a better way. And you have to close the microscopic light, and you complete the phaco emulsification. Same case, initially it was challenging, so it was not possible. Later on, when we used fiber optic light, we could finish it. And this is a very, recently, last 6 months, I am using the retrochandelier illumination through pars plana. So this is a chandelier light source, which we are using retro in the pars plana in the vitreous cavity. And then capsulorhex is being done. It's easy and simpler way, and it is effective. The only thing is that we have to be get used to it, because the depth perception is slightly altered in the such cases. Phaco emulsification being done, and you can see very clearly, and it aids or it helps in largely in such cases, and your life becomes very simple and easy. Irrigation aspiration, and I'll another case, retro chandelier. We don't use a fiber optic straight light. This is a chandelier illumination, so you get a uniformly illuminated posterior segment, and the pupil is also small. It's not, it was not dilating, and the cataract is also hard. So this helped us in a great way to rehabilitate the patient. Just get a good red reflex. And this is a 25 gauge fiber optic source, light source, so you don't have to put any suture also. To conclude, with proper diligence and care, one can successfully perform phaco in such compromised corneas and with corneal opacity. Visual outcome in these cases are less than optimal, which we have to explain to the patient. Patients gain enough vision to enable them to carry out their daily activities. Be prepared to convert to SICS or ECC. Thank you. Dr. Suhas, you are the
next. I think for want of time, we'll keep the questions at the end. Yeah. It's already we are running late.
Let us keep the questions till the end.
Yeah.
Good morning. First of all, Purendra, thank you so much for this invitation. Well, post-corneal refractive procedures is primarily more of a planning than a surgery. Corneal refractive surgeries could be either excimer laser surgery like LASIK or PRK, or it could be RK. Although today RK is not much done, but all those patients in whom we have done RK are today candidates for cataract surgery. There are some challenges. And those challenges, if you talk of radial keratotomy, they are in terms of IOL power calculation and to an extent surgical challenges. If you talk of excimer laser like LASIK or PRK, they are primarily IOL power calculations. Let's talk about radial keratotomy. When you have to calculate the IOL power, there are three errors that we have to look at. There could be corneal power measurement errors. There could be index of refraction errors, like the altered Gullstrand ratio, or it could be ELP prediction error, which is very much required in it's used in the formula algorithm. If you talk of RK, RK essentially causes a much smaller central zone of flattening, unlike the LASIK, as you can see here. The relation between anterior and posterior cornea is fortunately maintained in RK because it causes equal flattening of both the surfaces. The laser correction alters the anterior corneal curvature, but not the posterior one in LASIK, as against radial keratotomy. If you talk of these three errors, the corneal curvature error in RK is much more than in LASIK, but the index of refraction error and ELP prediction errors are minimal, and which to an extent helps you focus on what to look at when you're calculating the IOL power calculation. But the underestimation of IOL power due to overestimation of keratometry because of magnitude of error will depend on the number of RK cuts that you make. Then what are the solutions? Results, unfortunately, are not very predictable, but there is an asterisk calculator which is available with multiple input options from various machines, but always aim for minus one target refraction. You can take from your topography the central thinnest flattest K from the sagittal curvature map and add it while calculating. And unlike LASIK, there is no special need for equivalent KR or TNP because the posterior-anterior relationship is not affected. Sometimes even just doing a routine biometry and overcorrecting it by around -2 to 3 is also enough. Finally, it is the individual experience that counts. If you talk of surgical challenges, the RK wound gives way during phacoemulsification, but it depends on number of cuts that have undergone that were done on that cornea. So precaution needs to be taken because your cut has to be between the cuts, between the two RK cuts. The incision should be between the two cuts. You can start incision little posteriorly if there are too many number of cuts and there is no space between the two cuts. Obviously, phaco you would use with lower parameters simply because when you keep your bottle very high, that has a tendency to stretch the RK wounds, and you have to ensure that you don't stretch the wounds more because they sometimes can alter your IOL power calculation. If you look at this, now this is an RK done in the historical times with multiple cuts. So there was hardly any space, but still there was a folly on my part, because what I presumed to be between the two cuts was actually getting involved into one of the cuts. So at the end of the surgery, which I, like I said, the surgery wise, other than doing it with a bottle height low, there's no special need for it. So what I want you to see here is, even after your uneventful surgery, what happens is one of the cuts gives way. And at that time, you are required to take a suture, but that suture has to be sometimes vertical and horizontal combination, or sometimes even a horizontal one to just suture the cut should be enough. So what you see here is a horizontal cut. Now this is fairly a better position because the cuts are not many. This is how many? 8 cuts. So 8 cut gives you enough space between the cuts. So you can safely stay little posterior in the limbus, stay between the cuts, and that takes care. Now, otherwise, like in the previous patient, when I had to go for the second eye, I was a little wiser. I tried to make it in the sclera. And when you make it in the sclera, even if on top of that you have one of the cuts, it doesn't really matter because your cut is much deeper. But still, you would not go bang underneath a RK cut, and the surgery is uneventful. Choice of lens, again, is a part. IOL with negative spherical aberrations will correct spherical aberrations induced by myopic lacing. So it is better to go for aspheric with the maximum asphericity. Multifocals are normally not advised because they further reduce the contrast sensitivity, unless you are opting for a multifocal who doesn't do much of contrast loss, but which is not many. Following RK, the overall lack of precision of IOL power calculations, a diurnal fluctuation, which is very common in RK, unlike in LASIK, and increase in spherical aberrations, which is bound to happen, it precludes the use of diffractive multifocal IOL. So that means we are much safer with a monofocal with better contrast or contrast enhancing lenses like Technis, which gives you an improvement by reducing the chromatic aberrations as well. Talking about myopic LASIK, all right, myopic LASIK, here the cornea changes from oblate, prolate to oblate. Corneal power measurement error could be usually K for lens, for IOL power calculation, is taken at 2 to 3 millimeter zone. There's always an overestimation of central K due to oblate cornea, and lower IOL power because of hyperopic shift. So if I have to, talking about ELP prediction, keratometry plays an important role in ELP prediction. A flatter K leads to underestimation of ELP, so underestimation of IOL power, which leads to hyperopic shift. Myopic LASIK, all three errors cause underestimation of IOL power leading to large hyperopic shift. And hyperopic LASIK, exactly the opposite happens. So what are the solutions? Earlier, we used clinical history and hard PMMA contact lens method. Modern solutions are methods based on clinical history as of today. They don't need the clinical history. Directly uses optical biometric K values, where double K method is used. And there are several methods, but things have been much more simplified. with the modern Barrett K. When you use ocularizer, you get four different types of maps. You get sagittal curvature map, refractive map, true net K, and estimated K. So the equivalent K, which is supposed to give you a better estimation. This map was designed by Holiday, especially for accurate calculation. I'm done, sir. This Holiday K and Barrett True K is that has come as a panacea because it works beautifully. Or we can go on the Ascaris where there will be 7 or 8 formulas used and they give you an average. And even that has made life much simpler. And in fact, IOL Master 700, it uses Barrett suit, which uses OCT-derived true net K and Barrett true K formula for post-LASIK RK. So in conclusion, the rule of two, especially after post-RK, in spite of our best results, if the final refractive objective remains elusive, plan for an IOL exchange or a secondary piggyback. It should not be made until at least 2 months have passed and two separate refractions, which are stable, done at two separate times, give you that final verdict. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Swas.
Thank you.
As usual, you have really comprehended this elaborate time.
Thank you so much,
Thank Purendra. You for doing that and highlighting all the important aspects. May I request Dr. Revati for her talk? Sir, can I ask you one thing? That in post-RK patient, the central 2 millimeter or 3 millimeter corneal zone, I'm using true corneal power from Pentacam. So that gives me better estimation of the keratometry because there is not much change between anterior posterior difference change difference in the corneal surface. So that has helped me.
It basically would depend on how many. If you have four and a regular IOL master or any K that you do, which should give you. But question is when there are too many irregular cuts, there the true K would probably work.
Thank you. Thank you.
So probably, you know, like if I have to do and he's undergone surgery, I mean RK and has given him good result. And today after the cataract, he still wants to, or he wants toric lens, I would be a little hesitant.
For giving me this opportunity, and it's almost a continuation of what they have discussed. So in the presence of corneal opacity, like when we calculate, it depends on the whether it is superficial or deeper, or it is central or in the periphery. And so there's such a way that it will affect the IOL power calculation. And again, because of the irregular surface or irregular astigmatism or the abnormal curvature, it can lay down to IOL power calculation problems. So the errors can be in the, generally we use the manual K method, or we can use the over refraction, or automated keratometers we can use to calculate. All these things depends upon how clear the media is, and how whether we can do a refraction, whether we can use a contact lens, with the contact lens, whether we can do the over refraction, or whether we can at least record or document a topography. Depends on that, the density of the opacity or involvement only, we have to decide how to calculate. So in case we can use either contact lens over refraction or corneal topography, or in cases where this both are not possible, we can go for opposite eye calculation or presumed K value. So in contact lens over refraction, we should be able to, media should be clear enough to do a refraction first, manifest refraction. Then we can choose a contact lens of a known base curve, which is fitting very well to that particular cornea, then we have to do an over refraction. And the difference between these two refraction has to be added algebraically to the base curve. That's how the examples are given by, this is a chapter written by Dr. B.K. Nayak, in which it's very clearly explained like if it is a minus power or if it is a plus refraction, how we can calculate and algebraically we can add it to the base curve and find out the K with which we have to calculate the IOL. In corneal topography, as Dr. Basin mentioned, we can use this because even in contact lens over refraction, we are trying to calculate the total power. The same way, whenever the anterior posterior corneal surface relationship is altered, we can use this method. And generally, we started using it for post-refractive patients, especially myopic patients. And later, we tried this even on post-keratoplasty patients or even other irregular astigmatism, like keratoconus, we found it useful. So we used the OBSCAN, which is for the machine which first started giving this calculative possibility. So we can calculate like this the total mean power and total optical power within the first central 1.5 millimeter area, get the average, and then use this as K1 and K2 or the flattest one as the K in case of myopic refractive correction. Then we can calculate the IOL power. And I can tell you one example. This patient who had a corneal trauma and there is a almost central scar, and later we need to plan for a secondary IOL, and the refraction showed only 2 cylinder, but the topography showed about 8 cylinder, and the manual K showed about 10 cylinder, and the refractive and the IOL power was calculated as the 17 with the manual K method. So then we went in for the total mean power and optical power, and with that the K reading, it shows only 1.5 cylinder, almost matching the refractive error, and the IOL power was 19. So we went ahead and put 19, and 2 months post-op, the refraction is minus 2 cylinder, with which the 6/12 vision with the opacity almost in the central area. In case where the density, the opacity is too much, where we can't use these methods, either we have to go for a sequential surgery like a PK, first PK, or any kind of refractive, any kind of keratoplasty, and then wait for the refraction to stabilize, and then do that gives better results. But if it is not possible, then we can go for either we can take the other AK reading if the axial length are matching, and if it is a uniocular pathology, or if it is a binocular, then we can use either a presumed decay based on the surgeon's usual after the keratoplasty, how much the K reading used to be, or we can go for a normalized K. This is an example. One, the right eye, as you can see, massive pterygium now, and the left eye already underwent bilateral pterygium, handshaking pterygium, after which there is a opacity and a mature cataract. So we need to go for a triple procedure here. So we have done the same total optical and mean power and calculated, and it came as, actually we used the normalized K value. We went in for a 42.5 diopter, and then we calculated as plus 29, and we put that lens, and in the immediate post-op period, within 4-5 days, we calculated again the K reading and the IOL power. The K reading shows about 4 cylinder, and the IOL power is same, almost 28.5. But this K reading will change because it's an immediate post-op, post-DALK procedure. So when these methods were compared in this article, and they found the total mean power, optical power measurement with OBSCAN or the contact lens over refraction method is the most reliable one in these kind of cases. But still we should be ready that there may be definite surprises post-operatively. Patient should be warned, and we may need further procedures also to address these problems. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Revati. Dr. Praveen, may I just, we got the hall some 15, you can start, 15 minutes late. So just last talk. Can you comprehend it in 7 minutes or 6 minutes, Dr. Praveen? Dr. Revati is consultant at Arvind Eye Hospital, Coimbatore, and I really appreciate her talk which she has given.
Okay. A very good morning to all of you. So I'll try to cover up this as fast as possible. So my talk is on the menace of ocular surface diseases in cataract. So the question is, because most are the unhappy premium IOL patients, what we see, they might be having blurring of the vision at distance. They might be complaining of fluctuating vision, especially when reading or they might have glare and halos, which are usually the problems with this multifocal intraocular lenses, and they may also have decreased contrast sensitivity. So if we see blurring of vision, might be because of residual refractive error, which might be because of the inaccurate IOL power calculation ultimately resulting from the ocular surface disease. So similarly, fluctuating vision while reading or fluctuating vision per se can be a symptom of dry eye. So also glare and halos are, glare, halos, and decreased contrast sensitivity are known problems with the these premium intraocular lenses, and they might be exacerbated by the ocular surface disease. So the conditions which are to be addressed before cataract surgery are lid abnormalities, the dry eyes, or blepharitis, or meibomian gland dysfunction, or a set of corneal degenerations which we commonly see like Salzmann's and pterygium, or spheroidal degeneration, or anterior corneal dystrophies like epithelial basement membrane dystrophies, or corneal ectatic disorders, and astigmatism. So coming to the dry eye, which is most common, so in most of the cases, the cataract surgery in itself can exacerbate the dry eye because of topical medications, the corneal incisions, and pro-inflammatory status post-operative care. So the potential problems that might result from the dry eye include inaccurate IOL calculations and residual refractive error, or blurred vision, or fluctuating vision, glare and halos, and decreased contrast sensitivity. So it is very important to identify all these patients preoperatively, and you should take proper history regarding if they already have dry eye, or if they are on any medications, or if they have any connective tissue diseases. And a proper preoperative evaluation is very important. And topography, especially the placidus disc, might be of very helpful in subclinical cases. So this, you can see, just we are more inclined towards putting a drop of artificial tears before taking any keratometry readings. Here you can see this one, how after instillation of the artificial tears, the mires have become regularized. So this should not be done. Sometimes it might mask the abnormalities. So. And also proper staining and evaluation is very important. Sometimes the fluorescein staining might not be adequate, so stain with the lissamine green, which might give some of the existing dry eye. And you also need to evaluate the dry eyes properly, and tear osmolarity might be of very helpful. And there is a study which says that if abnormal or hyperosmolar tear status is associated with inappropriate IOL power calculations. And also MMP9 might be used for evaluation in subclinical cases. So pre and post operative management consists of artificial tears, omega-3 fatty acids, and topical cyclosporine, topical low potency, topical steroids, punctal plugs, and autologous serum. So there's a study which compared cyclosporine to improve the visual outcomes after multifocal intraocular lenses. The patients who received cyclosporine perioperatively were more satisfied with the vision than patients who received only artificial tears. So we can treat the dry eye based on the recent recommendation of TFOS and DUS 2, that is 2017. So coming to meibomian gland disease, which should be addressed, and we should always recommend them to do eyelid scrubs and warm compresses. Topical antibiotics like azithromycin 1% can be used, omega-3 supplements, and oral doxycycline or minocycline or azithromycin. So azithromycin can be given as a dosage of 1 gram per orally every week for 3 weeks before. So this is a case of epithelial basement membrane dystrophy, which is also more common, and we see map-like changes in the most patients, which usually take negative staining with fluorescein. So vision affected by irregular astigmatism and scarring, and it can get worse after cataract extraction with IOL. So key is to see it and to tell the patient about it before the procedure. So this is, you can see the AIOC2018 of the same patient with irregularities. And this is after treatment with PTK. So this is another common degenerative condition which we see here. And this is a Salzmann's nodular degeneration, which are characterized by gray-white elevated nodular lesions, usually in the mid-periphery or the periphery. They are most commonly seen in females, and there is no clear etiology, but may be associated with meibomian gland disease and ocular surface inflammation. And they usually give irregular astigmatism. So here you can see, this is the case. On the left side, you can see preoperatively, the patient has around 4.68 diopters of astigmatism at 116 axis. So just after removing this Alzheimer's nodule, the astigmatism has come down to 3.24 diopters. So similarly, pterygium, which is a mass of fibrovascular tissue, and it's more common in men and outdoor workers, which usually causes withdrawal astigmatism. So now the question is whether excision and the change in the corneal power are associated with the pterygium. So was that, yes, that depends upon the magnitude of the pterygium. But generally, there are several studies which have shown that any pterygium which is more millimeter on the cornea after excision, of which there is some change in the keratometry values. So if you are planning for any premium intraocular lens, then please address the issue of pterygium before. So here you can see the two eyes of the pterygium and how the irregularity of the Myers on the Placidus disc. So this is a patient who had undergone the multifocal intraocular lens in the right eye, and now she had very good vision, and she had come for the left eye cataract surgery, which had some amount of pterygium, and she also had 1.52 diopters of cylinder, you can see here. So we did a pterygium surgery, and then later on we planned for multifocal intraocular lens, and just after doing the pterygium surgery, and now she is having astigmatism, residual astigmatism of 0.5 diopters. So take home message is, look for ocular surface pathology carefully preoperatively in all cataract surgery patients, and ocular surface disease is often the source of symptoms in our unhappy postoperative patients, and corneal topography and Placido rings can provide valuable information, and optimizing the ocular surface before, during, and after surgery may give surgeons the best chance to providing patients with the wow effect of cataract surgery. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Praveen. And with this, we conclude our session and the questions independently with the speakers. Thank you.